各位与会的朋友们，线上的听众朋友，大家好。那由我高美馆的助理策展人方彦翔来主持这一场阳面的session。那这一场的主题事实上回到就是从海洋重新又回到这个当代艺术的论域的关注这件事情上。那不管是海洋，不管是作为一个生态的系统，或是一个生存的一个场域，或者是它是作为一个权力的领地，那这之间非常复杂、非常多层次的议题，也都在许多的艺术家以及策划人他们之间的关注中，进行重新的思辨和对话。那这一场很高兴，场次上的安排，我们安排了三组的对话，三组的发表与对话。那第一场会由本届第16届的日耳双年展的两位策展人阿利亚和阿尤斯，他们为我们来发表，以这次16届日耳双年展的主题，谁拥有海洋以及根源路线这样的主题，然后介绍整个日耳双年展的面貌以及整个架构艺术家的表现。那第二个部分，我们会请到跟我们高雄市立美术馆合作非常熟悉又非常的非常有渊源的纽西兰的 Ruben Friend 馆长。那 Ruben Friend 在整个与他同时也是我们泛南岛艺术季的策展顾问，那跟我们高美馆的合作上非常深的渊源，待会在他的简报中也会呈现。那第三场次，我们会有本次由泛南岛艺术季推出参与日耳双年展台湾馆的三位艺术家张志忠、邱杰森和莫山南，我们会进行一个现场的对话，然后进入他们的不管是他们的创作，或是他们对于整个发表上的看法。那我现在就来先进行介绍第一组的演讲。那第一组的阿利亚和阿尤斯，他们希望在这个日耳双年展的主题上，透过根源路径的主题，然后来去回应海洋整个悠久的，不管从殖民的历史到整个生存，到整个地缘政治以及艺文发展之间的动态的一个现象。那里面所触及的课题会包括原民性、种族、领土边界、离散、神话、现代性等等的非常多重的问题。那他们如何在这个策展中，打开这些议题的对话，以及重新回到在地的知识的生产上，然后回到整个在地的当代艺术的一个动态上。那我非常高兴能够邀请他们一起为我们演讲。那也简单的介绍一下两位讲者，就是阿利亚Novesta， 他是一位跨域艺术家。那他的主要的创作其实都是以跨学科的方法，并且其中一部分专注于实务上的论述。那其实阿利亚他跟台湾也有非常多的渊源。那他曾经在台北艺术村，他曾经在台北表演艺术中心进行过亚当计划实验室的计划。那他也参与 Gagoma 举办的第九届亚太当代艺术三年展。阿尤斯是一位工作于历史、建筑和美术等跨领域的作者和策展人。那他近期之间非常的活跃于跨越各种不同的区域的许多的创作，而这些创作都重新又回到了在地的知识内容，特别是在东南亚，并且对话于不管是文化、城市或是文化遗产上面的各种跨不同场域的论述上面的发展。因此我非常高兴的欢迎他们来进行这一场发表。
Yeah, good afternoon everyone. Thank you for inviting us to this forum. So we were really excited and appreciate with the invitation. And firstly, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Elia Nurvista, and together with my colleague Ayos Purwo Aji, also sit on the next right to me. We will speak in this forum about the curatorial theme of Jogja Biennale 16 Indonesia with Oceania. I would gimana bikin presentasi? Okay, I'll change to presentation mode. We are sorry for our not so handy using this platform. Yeah, so with the title "Who Owns the Ocean?" By me and Ayos Purwo Aji. So also I would like to a little bit inform you that the Jogja Biennale is still happening right now. We had the opening since 6th of October and we're running into 15th of November. And along with the main exhibition, Roots and Roads, we also have the Bilik or like a pavilion of Taiwan and Korea as well. And also we have a public program like a forum, symposium, talks, workshop, movie screening, and many events during the Biennale. So, yeah, I would like to maybe a little bit introduction about the Jogja Biennale Equator Series. I believe maybe yesterday Alia, our director, is already talk about that, but just to refresh. So the Equator Series was born with the spirit of challenging and re-questioning the unequal geopolitical division between the North and the South that was constructed by colonial power and implicates on the global contemporary art world. So we want to enforce the spirit of solidarity between the region through the Equator Series. It is a way to build a new perspective and openings in order to redefine ourselves through the critical and the colonial perspective. Therefore, we wish that the Biennale Jogja Equator can be a common platform to reread the world by focusing on central region around the equator belt with non-center perspective. Okay, sorry, Pang, you want to say something? Okay, then I continue. So, as you might already know that the Equator Series of Jogja Biennale is always moving along the equator line. So we had India in 2011 and then Arab region to cover like the Middle East region. And then in 2015, we continue with Nigeria in of Africa and then Brazil. And then the last one before this now, it's with Southeast Asia. And then to enclose this Equator Series, we're working with the Oceania. So when we start working, since the last January, me and Ayos officially being part of the curatorial team Jogja Biennale, we try to explore the notion of the Pacific. So before we using the term of a Pacific, before we move, we change shift to Oceania. And we also face our distance and unfamiliarity about how we imagine the Pacific itself. And because currently we are unfamiliar with this region, because yeah, we are rarely talk about the Oceania or a maritime culture in Indonesian art contemporary discourse. And also we think when the modernization and the paradigm of continental thinking have pushed aside our maritime culture, it's always much easier for us to imagine Indonesia as a part only for like a Southeast Asia than to identify ourselves as a part of a archipelago network that is directly connected to the island countries in the Oceania region. Like, of course, when Indonesian archipelago from the west to the east, it's quite large, and how we seen ourselves as only this is also like colonial constructed how we imagine ourselves only in Southeast Asia region. So yeah, like we mentioned in our text that in fact of geoanthropologically, the people in the eastern part of Indonesia, including the West Papua, the Moluccas, and the island along the east Nusa Tenggara, have a diverse genetic and cultural variation closely resembling those of Oceania. So also within this notion, we also reflect on how Indonesian culture was built by a very Java-centric paradigm, very Java-centric way of thinking. I just give very briefly context, like Java is an island where the capital, Jakarta, in there. And so all the powers, the politic, economic, and culture were centered in Jakarta. So every decision about the whole Indonesia is always made in Jakarta politician, which might be this kind of regulation or government. It's very common in the sense of state organizing, but for us that make us lack of understanding of the situation in many places, including in the east of Indonesia. So departing from that, we start to learn and also unlearn, because since in our elementary school we already fit how we seen and perceive about the East culture of Indonesia, which is very it's kind of standardization of the Java people to talk about other region in Indonesia. So we unlearn about that, and then when we learning about that, we entangle with the issue of indigeneity mostly. It's like how we call it maybe in Taiwan context, like aborigine. In Indonesia, it's called it adat. And in the process of learning, that we believe that something that I used to say it as like a traditional way of living, but in the process of learning, I believe that the value, the movement, the fighting, the struggle by this tribe or indigenous is really a contemporary way of living. Yeah, so I give to Ayos to continue about our process of shaping the curatorial team.
Thank you, Elia, and hello everyone. Thank you for the invitation. And instead of using term Pacific in the Biennale Jogja, this year we are using Oceania, because inspired by the anthropologist or cultural thinker Eppli Hovhaava, that described the Pacific is coming from the colonial or explorer's point of view, that perceive the great oceans, least in the middle of nowhere, can be free to exploit it or extract it. So we trying to figure about how people in Pacific think about themselves, and we are meet with the Eppli essay about Oceania, and he described that ocean as a home that connecting the island and islanders, and the ocean become the entity that shapes the culture and identity of humans living within. We also want to talk more about the maritime culture that connect the sea and the land, so we can embrace the sea as a living space, trade routes, contested area of power and politics, social and culture, and also source of economic. With this perspective, to change the term Pacific into the ocean region, we will also open up the possibility of a progressive expansion of the ocean and Oceanian identity, that it might cover much wider region and more communities than what had been covered by the term Pacific, that shaped by the colonial regime. at that time. So we want to was like expand the term of the ocean, not just the term, but also the how we perceive the eastern part of Indonesia is also part of the ocean region. That's why Alia and I, Alia and I, we are using the term roots and route as our title for this Biennale, so we can stretch the tension from the idea of attachment and detachment, because from the colonial history, the discovery of cartography, the expansion of transportation, and the emergence of internationalist ideas caused the phenomenon of migration and the appearance of an indigenous diaspora all around the world. So we want to check or to investigate that kind of notion. Because we are thinking this physical displacement has also created communities of people who are detached from their homelands. In these new lands, they recognize the ways of life they once knew in order to form a mixed culture through processes of negotiation and assimilation, which continued over several generations. In Indonesia itself, we have a complexity history on colonialism and also the context of Oceania. That's, we think that it can generate more layers on how we learn and to understand more about indigeneity, indigenous First Nations or aborigines, tribes and adat in the region. So that's the story behind the title Roots and Routes. So far we have 34 participating artists that comes from lots of region in Indonesia. Some of them are coming from Papua. There are also artists who comes from Madura Island, Flores Island, Timor Island, Moluccas, and also we invite some artists from Timor Leste, New Caledonia, Naoshima, Okinawa, and some other places in Oceania. Through their works, we want to cover issues of territorial borders and land eviction. Of course, with enclosed access of resources, and also we want to talk about migration, refugee, and diaspora, mythology and modernity, situated knowledge, and ecological crisis, and also in the ideology of development and the limit of growth. That kind of issues, those kind of issues that we want to was like reread with this Biennale. Maybe Alia want to talk.
Yeah. Thank you, Mas Aya. So we are in between, yeah, we talk, completing each other. So yeah, this is now we move to the image of the part of the artworks. So this is made, it's like a mural, 7 by 12 square meters, the size. And this is also light on our facade of the building, the Jogja National Museum, when we where we held this Biennale. And Yanto is an artist from Papua, and I think it's really really a strong image about how the situation in Papua happened. Like Ayos mentioned previously about the theme of there is so many kind of issue of land eviction, the resource of like a mining or food estate that implies on how Papuan people live. So Yanto itself is a part of the Udeido collective, which is, this is also part of the Udeido. So there are 8 members of artists from Jayapura, from Papua, that is in Jayapura, Sentani, Fakfak, and other area. And in this Biennale, firstly we think about how this kind of style or sense of the art piece which is very tied with their local way of living, but also in the same time, this is the struggle. This is the things that happens in many places in the world, not only in the Oceania or in the Papua. So we think through this work, it's we can sense broadly about the extraction that still happen, mostly in the name of the development and modernization. And we will show some of the art piece artworks in this Biennale, and this is from Lako Atku Jawa. So they are a collective or community based in Molo in Kupang in Timor Island. So their activities as a community is to it's like a pedagogical practice, like they made a school for the younger people to get know more or preserve the situated knowledge that they have. For example, in this Biennale, they bring the Uambubu. It's like the round house. It's not only about the physically house, but it's really tied with how human and ecology should be living together. For example, through the house, there is many knowledge of languages, of food preserve, and agriculture, and then many things that it's really centered at the house. So this is of course, in this Biennale they seems like only bring the artifact, but for us it is important because they also still keep doing the activities of the school in their context, which is it's important for us to also invite them to come to the Biennale, which is in Java. That maybe people in Java is really unfamiliar with this way of living. And then another works, it's by Greg Semu. He's an Australian artist, and within his work in this Biennale, he reenactment the fragment of for example, when the Captain Cook comes, and in the global history it always said that menemukan, discover the Australia, but it seems like there is no man living in that island, but actually there is an aborigine people living there. So what he do with his work is he reenact and try to re-questioning critically about what who's made the history, what kind of the history that we perceive as a truth. And then also in this edition, he was working with the Taiwanese aborigine to also build this kind of a fragment through the photography. So it's really strong to talk about the colonial period. And this works by Sivanjani Lai. Sivanjani is a descendant of India, which his family moved to Fiji because of the sugar plantation, but now she's become an Australian citizen, and she retelling how the family migrating, and then what kind of what drives what kind of power that drive them to move. In the very colonial past, it's like a sugar plantation, but also for example in Indonesian. In Java also, there is so many Javanese people moved to New Caledonia because of the mining. So this kind of capital, which is now still happen until now, about the extraction that move bring people to come in and also to get out from their land. This is something that we also want to talk through this Biennale. So Also, this is Sivan Jani's work. It's for me. I seen it's also connected with other works. It's by Broken Beach. It's a collective based in Yogyakarta, and they are exploring about the how the this kind of migration. It's creating a Creole language and identity, which is it's become our reality today. There is nothing that very original. So I think this also lead to another works talking about the originality, the ownership. There is a group of it's called a port is the reverse of an island. So they're working with the idea of they're working with the issue of a refugee. So when I mentioned previously, because somehow the border is really racist, you know, like you are not belong to this area because you are not originally from there, and what is originality. So yeah, I think it's also important to bring this the voice of the refugee. So there is a refugee camp in Jakarta that mostly occupied by the Afghanistan people, but their aim, their purpose is go to Australia, but since the border was closed, so they are stuck in Indonesia, and until they don't know, even somehow there is a 9 years, 15 years, and this kind, this collective solidarity networking is build the activities mostly to gain the donation to provide or to help to donate for their basic daily needs with so many artistic intervention. Yeah, so this is some of the art works that, and then we still have, maybe now I just continue.
Yeah, this work is coming from a women artist, Ika Arista. Actually, she is a kris maker, the traditional dagger of Madura Island. For this Biennale, she wants to tell the story about the pirates which become the modes of decolonization in Indonesia, because at that time when the Dutch colonialism in Indonesia is still running, when the was like the Dutch colonies have a strong regulation of the sea, of the oceans, that was like make the traditional was like a sailor became a pirate to was like fight this kind of regulation of the Dutch colonies. And also Ika Arista in this works note some kind of local tradition or situated knowledge that coming from the people who live in the small islands in the Madura, which they will bring some of the amulets before the travels aboard with the ship. This is a young photographer, Ersal Umamit. He is coming from Banda Island. As we know, Banda was a producer of nutmeg, which invite a lot of European coming to Eastern Indonesia at that time to colonize the land, to colonize the people in there. Within these works, Ersal want to tell us the story of was like the old trauma, because they were genocide in Banda Island, because the Dutch want to monopolize the nutmeg trading at the time. But from the photograph, Ersal also want to was like tell us the future genocide that coming from the climate crisis that currently happening in the small island in Indonesia. that I think it resembles what happens in lots of island country in the Oceania, that now they're trying to fight the climate crisis coming to their island. This work is coming from Motoyuki Sitamichi, a Japanese artist, which he wants to document the coastal area that was hit by the tsunami, and what's happening there, and what's how the landscape is changing after the tsunami hit the island. I also want to note that this Biennale, we have docking programs that aims to position decentralization as a real practice that one day could be imitated and multiplied, because we think that the biennalization itself is kind of centralization. Since 2011, Jogja Biennale has tried to establish its own position as an important event in the field of global art, which until now has been centered in Europe or the United States. In each of its edition, the Equator series, the Jogja Biennale has included artists from other countries and regions in the imaginary line of the Equator, spanning from India, the Arab states, Nigeria, Brazil, and to the countries of Southeast Asia. From this location on the planet, artists have been flown to show their works to Jogja. They have to work and to exhibit their works to Yogyakarta. For the small handful of art enthusiasts in Jogja. So we think from that kind of working mode, we think that the Biennale Jogja itself is also about the centralization. It's become the new centralization of the art world itself. So in order to avoid the tendency of the centralizing, and we want to talk more about the decentralization issues, we want to test the following questions or premises. Can Jogja Biennale as an art event or art institution be decentralized? To what extent can we decentralize the Biennale itself? Because I think this kind of docking program, it's also kind of autocratic for the Biennale itself. So through the docking programs, we want to looking more about how can we decentralize the Biennale Jogja. So for this year, Biennale Jogja not only happened in Yogyakarta, because we co-produced some other programs with institutions or art collective in eastern part of Indonesia. They were in the Jayapura in Papua, in Maumere, Flores, in Kupang, Timor Island, and also in Ambon, Moluccas. With this docking program, we want to talk more about the local issues with the pendekatan tuh,
approach
of a local people to the local people. In Jayapura, they want to make some tribute to Mambesak. Mambesak is one of the cultural activists from Papua that was shut down by the government in the late 80s. So now they want to recontextualize the Mambesak activities or the Mambesak was a legacy to the Papua culture. In Maumere, we were working with Komunitas Kahe, a group of an artist that they want to try to decolonize the local museum that was built by the Christian mission in the Flores Island. So they are making art activities or art intervention in this in that museum. To retell the story, the was like a connection between the Christian mission with the colonization and how modernity is happened in the local context. In Kupang, we were working with Skolmus, the group of multimedia artists in Timor Island, that was like looking through the phenomenon of migrant worker, because not only in the Oceania, we are in the eastern part of Indonesia also have the was like a migrant worker problems, and how the migrant worker to take care in the new land is quite bad. So they working looking to this kind of problem. And the last is Hinamasa Waya, is a performing art that happened in the Ambon Straits in Moluccas, that now they are facing the natural threat, because lots of coastal island, coastal area in the Ambon is facing the reclamation, and the reclamation process causing the problems of natural problems for the people in living in Ambon. So I think with this kind of docking program, we want to moving forward how we can decentralize this Biennale, and how not to make the Biennale becoming the centralization, the new centralization of the art world in Indonesia. So I think that's all. Thank you very much.
And sorry if we are over time, like 10 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, thank you.
Thank you.